After such an introduction of Vijay Nambisan and the kind of the talent he was, I'm very uncertain whether I'll be able to do justice to his memory for which this lecture has been organized. Nevertheless, I'm very thankful to the trustees of the Vijay Nambisan Trust to call me here. I will try my best to see that the trust that you have reposed on me, I'll try to, reciprocate by saying as much as, and as sharply as possible. I'm not a public speaker. You might not have heard my name in the newspapers too. I don't write in public too much, although I edit a journal, Indian Journal of Medical Ethics. But even in that journal, you won't find a lot of things written by me. Much of my writings are all research writings. I do a lot of teaching. Teaching I love. But the public speaking gives me real butterflies. I feel very nervous. I don't know how to speak for 1.5 hours or 1 hour from the podium. So it's really a challenge. What I'm asked to do and what I thought needs to be done in the present situation in the healthcare in India was to explore two relationships. That is what Kaveri and I agreed to. One was to look at doctor-patient relationship, and another was look at the relationship between the society and the healthcare system that we have. Because both of them are very closely related. I'm going to just make 4 points, if possible, in 30 minutes so that we can have more interaction, because this institution is made for interaction and not lectures, as I can see it. 4 points are to look at what is changing in the relationship. What is the foundation of it and what is changing in it? So we go to the issue of conflict. Is there a conflict there between the society and healthcare, or the interests of the society and the interests of the healthcare as it is now? And on the other hand, interests of the patient and the interests of the doctors. Second is to look at how we have come there, to this kind of situation. Third is to say something about, are the doctors happy with what is happening today? Or who are the doctors who are happy and who are the doctors who are unhappy in this situation? And the last is an open area where I'll make a few comments is to discuss about where we go from here. Is there a cooperation possible? If it is possible, then under what kind of framework that would be possible? Now, as you know, that the core of relationship as that we are describing, doctor-patient and society and health services, that relationship, as many people will tell you, and we who talk about medical ethics, we keep telling all the time, is the relationship of trust. And the crisis is the crisis of trust of the society and patients and the healthcare services and the doctors. As I was preparing this lecture, I thought that I should also try to learn something about Vijay Nambisan. I had not read anything about him. I saw him only once, that also in 2015, when Kaveri had come to National Bioethics Conference at St. John's Medical College, and he accompanied him. So I just looked at him from a distance, and somebody told me that he's Kaveri's husband. I had no idea that he was a poet. Then I Googled and I found that, yeah, he's a big poet, and he has written quite a lot. So I thought that let me just go through some material to understand what Vijay Nambisan would have liked to say on this. And then I found something which was I was very surprised that he also wrote on ethics. I never knew about it. And I would like to get the copy of the book sometime as soon as I go back and get hold of this copy of this book called Language as an Ethic. And I thought, well, this is an important issue, both in philosophy as well as in ethics, that we dissect the language and how it is articulated in various situations. And there he said one thing. You know, I had not read his original stuff, but something that is quoted by a reviewer is that at the core of the communication is not the words and the images, but it is the integrity. Devoid of integrity, the language assumes the political and manipulative nature. And I think this suffix really hit me very hard, that when we are talking about trust, the trust is based on the integrity of the people who are involved in the relationship. If integrity is eroded, then the trust gets eroded. I think that's how, I think you can say that it is not the crisis of trust as much as the crisis of integrity. If you bring back the integrity in the relationship, the trust will come automatically. And trust will not be a blind trust as it used to be once upon a time when we said that doctors were demigod and everything that they were talking about, we were able to accept as a wisdom. Instead of that, we'll say, yes, we trust, but we verify. We also make you accountable. So accountability and trust can become joined together rather than they being, juxtaposed against each other. Today, it is like that if you become too trustworthy, then the accountability goes, because then you do not really question the person whom you trust. You know, in last 3 days, I was in Delhi. I came to Bombay yesterday night, and then I came here today morning. In 3 days, there was a conference there, international conference, which is called Accountability. It's called COPASA. And the large number of health activists from different parts of the world came, mainly from the developing world, but few people from the developed world too. And their whole agenda was that how do we make healthcare system accountable? And these were the people who were working at the grassroots level, who have been interaction with the communities as well as the patients. And they were talking both about the public health system as well as the private health system. And some of the things they were narrating was quite horrible, the kind of things that are happening in the health system. Many of them were doctors there. And of course, when medicine is criticized too much, doctors become very defensive. And we say, no, there is other side of the story. There is always other side of story. But at the same time, the instances, one after another, which were narrated in the sessions that I attended and chaired some of them, were eye-opening. You know, I thought that this was happening only in a few big centers of India. But I found that this is a widespread phenomenon, of different kind of things that they were talking about. First was, and that I think as a activist of Medical Friend Circle, we have been raising it since 70s and early 80s, was that the whole loyalty of the doctors is shifting. You know, one of the major principles of ethics is that doctors should have undivided loyalty to the patient. And this is a very, very important thing, because you cannot have conflict of interest at all. You must have that person's best interest in your mind when you are interacting, because doctor intervenes, and doctor's intervention can have effect of life and death for the person on whom the intervention is being carried out. And they said that, well, that whole loyalty has shifted, and initially, they were more loyal to the self, in the sense that, because they had no choice, they were entrepreneurs, because they were running small businesses. But now it is much more than that. Their friendship with the pharmaceutical companies, the device companies, and the big hospital has increased to such an extent that patients whose case studies and narration that were provided there, they were feeling that doctor is not our man or our person, our woman. This large number of doctors are women now, because either, irrespective of the gender, both of them seem to have belief that pharmaceutical company is a good friend. I was always taught when I started getting into medicine and activism that your relationship with the pharma companies and device companies and the big corporates is a conflict of interest. You must try to bring it down, or you just don't have it. And if you have it a little bit, you must disclose it to your patient. But now, when I talk to them, and what many doctors say is that it is not the conflict of interest, it is the confluence of interest. It's their interest and our interest go together, because pharma companies are also working for the patient. We are working for the patient. So both of them should work together. And so today, unlike in the past, when they used to have this relationship, they used to hide it. Today they flaunt it. You know, it's like the way, you know, casteism and communalism has come about in India. Once upon a time, you have to scratch people to find out whether they are casteist or communal or not. Today they come on the TV and they come in the public forum and say that I am it, you know, and then they say that they are proud of doing it. I think this is what is happening in the medical profession too. The second type of thing was the financial exploitation. I'm sure any one of you have gone to the private medical institution might have faced it. The big bills, the cost of care is so high. They first try to look at your, you know, insurance rather than trying to find out what you are having. They are so technologically oriented that they hardly touch you, but they want to do a lot of, you know, diagnostic all the time. All kind of such, complaints that were narrated there. In addition to that, there were a lot of things about, what you call operation, you know, saying that in an intimidation, saying that if you don't pay your bill, even when you disagree with things that they have not done, saying that why have you charged me for the drugs that you are not given or the procedure you are not done, they won't allow you to go away. They won't allow a dead person's body to be taken away. And this is despite a lot of, court orders saying that you cannot do it. I just remember a year back, a friend of mine who is a psychiatrist who studied in KEM Hospital, then migrated to UK. And he is now in the National Health Services there. And his father was very sick in Bombay. And he came down all of a sudden, and he calls me up saying that I am a big hospital run by a big industrial house, well known in Bombay. And Sanjay is laughing because he knows what it is. Who is the big industrial house? Anyway, he's there, and I find that he is being treated wrongly. And he's a doctor himself, and he said that he's not improving, and I want to take him away. And so I told them that we will be, taking him, the patient, back home, and we'll go to another hospital. Then they gave him a bill which ran into several lakh rupees. And he examined the bill, and he found out that out of some 5-7 lakh rupees bill, there was a 1.5 lakh rupees were overcharged of totally wrong kind, where nothing was done. So he said, I will not pay this. And he paid the remaining money. And he tried to take his father. As soon as he went to the elevator and he was going down at the ground floor, the bouncers from the hospital came and, surrounded him. He said, you cannot take your father unless you pay the remaining money. He said, but I have explained to you that this is not the, the amount to be paid. He said, nothing doing. You will have to do that. He said, he called me up. He's surrounded by, he calls me, and he said, this is what has happened. So I just got in contact with a lawyer friend, and I sent all the judgments of the High Court, Bombay High Court, saying that it says very clearly that you cannot detain a patient. They can file a case, they can do anything else they like. I said, why don't you contact a policeman? There will be policemen at the hospital. He said, policeman is also with them. And they are working closely together. So he had to go back, he has to make all the payment. When he goes back home, he's so agitated, he said, I want to fight. I said, that is good, we like fight, people who want to fight. I'm a doctor, but I have been helping a lot of patients like this. So I contacted a journalist. He spoke to the journalist. The journalist also spoke to me and a few other people. I put together a story. Next day morning, they will publish. Then suddenly around 7 o'clock in the evening, a call comes and from this doctor. He said that my whole family is petrified. They are worried that I have talked to the media and the story is going to come in Mumbai Mirror. You know, that is where it was scheduled to be published. And they are nervous wreck because I'll be going back to UK. These people will be here and they think that if you know, they make noise, then they will have a problem with other doctors. And he pleaded with me, he said, can you ask the journalist to withdraw the story? And it was a really very embarrassing for me to get this story withdrawn. But this is the power of medicine. And this intimidation that I saw happening to my friend, similar kind of stories that I had you know, come to know from in that conference. Between 1987 to 1993, you know, these were the years when after you know, Consumer Protection Act was brought in, we had a large number of medical malpractice cases I had handled. And I had found it extremely difficult because listening to each story, I must have handled 100 cases at that time. Several of them went to the court. Many of them decided not to, you know, go to the court and fight. I think patients are not interested in fighting. In majority of the cases that I saw was that they wanted to understand what went wrong. Secondly, they wanted larger system to change rather than they getting compensation. And majority of those, I mean, half a dozen or so who went to the court till and fought till the last, they all said that we don't want money for ourselves, we'll give it in charity. But we want some kind of, you know, pressure built on the medical profession so that they don't behave like this. So this has been happening for a long time. That I've seen that it in 80s and 90s. I've seen also that some of the cases still keep coming to me in this manner. And so it is a situation which is extremely problematic, you know, today. The last thing that I heard in that meeting, as well as we have been talking in medical friend circle, as well as even biotics group quite a lot, was the allegations of prejudices that doctors have. I mean, when I studied medicine in 1970s in Gujarat, yes, there were some amount of prejudices, but it was understood that the professionalization of the doctors that takes place in the medical school will ensure that the doctor's ethics will be aligned to the healthcare ethics, which does not allow any kind of prejudices to seep in. We are always taught that we cannot discriminate anybody when we are treating somebody, right? So no caste, no religion, no ethnicity, no nationalism either. You know, and if an enemy is sick, you have to go and treat that person. That is what is your job. Irrespective of you know, the person's affiliation, that is what you are supposed to do. And that is ingrained in the, it is a part of the ethics and in the, as a larger healthcare ethics. But I knew that in personal life, people were not like that. Even today when I teach medical students, I always ask them that how many of you are casteist or communal, and none of them raise his hand. But at the same time, when I ask them that how many friends you have from the lower caste or minorities, and very few hands will come up. So this is also shows that, and then I find that the kind of alliances which are built, the marriage is one very important area that I found that where they always fall in love with a person who is from their own caste or from their own religion and not else. So I understand that at the personal level, people have their own morality. But that we ensure, try to see that medical ethics does not allow them to cross the boundary and bring their personal morality into the medical practice. But that is what seems to be seeping in quite a lot nowadays. And many people, and if you talk to people who are marginalized communities, the tribals, the you know, people who are Dalits, the Muslims, and you talk to them, particularly those who are very poor among them, they would keep telling you that those prejudices are very strong. And we go and find a doctor who is flaunting his religion without any kind of inhibition. And they do overhear doctors and other people talking, very derogatory things about them. And I think this is another area which is very, very important. I think the doctors or Indian origin doctors who will never be able to say anything derogatory about minorities and on racism and all in America and UK, when I see their WhatsApp messages, they are all my classmates because there's a WhatsApp group of my classmates. When I see their messages about India and Dalits and Muslims in India, I find they are extremely derogatory and they don't mind for putting it up there because it is going to India. I think this is what we call a Lakshman Rekha of medical profession that is being crossed, you know, very, very regularly. The last thing that about this relationship that was brought out, and I think doctors will bring it out much more, is the issue of violence. The doctor's side will always say that the physical violence against them is a very, very big issue. And those who are doctors here, I'm sure they'll feel quite emotionally charged on it. But all these things that I described earlier, which came from the patient side, I also find it a kind of violence against patients. So there is things were happening on both the sides, and that is leading to a real problem between the doctors and patients or the health services and the people. We only 6 months back we published a paper from China on the violence against healthcare providers there in Indian Journal of Medical Ethics. If you have a look at it, it's based on media reports of the violence against health providers and the hospitals, and they found that it was very, very rampant there. Although certain areas were having more, other areas were having less. But at the same time, I was quite fascinated by one thing that they have mentioned, is that since there is no recourse, there is no redress available easily for these people, they also have started taking direct action in addition to all these conflicts that is going on. I found a mention of something called E-NAO, Y-E-I-N-A-O, which translates as healthcare disturbance, which are gangs of people, youngsters, who help patients who feel victimized by the system, either overcharging or there is an injury in the health system and they are not providing compensation or something like that. And these gangs of people, they go and ransack hospitals. They beat up doctors, right? These are all independent gangs. You can say urban guerrilla warfare kind of stuff, This is the situation that has come to. I don't know whether India is going in that direction. And that shows that the kind of, conflict and the kind of distress that is existing. Let me bring back Vijay here. I found something. I don't read poetry, but then I saw a poem, and I can't resist but read it out. It's a few lines. It is from the First Infinities. I don't know whether and in which context he wrote, and I have no idea. It's called Deserted Temple. I thought. But as healthcare was a deserted temple. Once upon a time, doctors were demigod there. And now, it is a deserted temple, so this must be, must fit there quite well. He said, if the god is gone, his cave is bare. Even Modi can go to the caves, but this cave will remain bare all the time. In the shadow from the sun, the clotted beds hang from the roof. Below the scorpion run, and pious folks no longer come, the less evil should be done. I'm not a good reader of the poetry. I never got any kind of training under Vijay. But that is what he is saying, that this is, the integrity, the kind of soul of the medicine is dying out, as far as I can see it. That spirit is evaporating. I think that is the whole area of conflict. Let me go to the remaining things as quickly as possible. The second is, how we have come to this. This is an area of my work in public health, but I'm not going to elaborate on it. It's a very simple thing that can we blame doctors just for all these things are happening, or there is something larger than that? And you, for that, you have to see the history in the way health system has evolved in India. Our health system was not supposed to be like this when we started. In UK, there was a Beveridge Committee report of 1948. Some of you might have heard about it, because that was the report which established National Health Services in UK. And this principle was that nobody should be deprived of healthcare services irrespective of their capacity to pay. We had a similar report here in 1946 by Joseph Bohr. Joseph Bohr was an Indian, and the whole committee made up of Indian experts, they all went around. They learned from British experience, they learned from Soviet Union experience at that time, and they came out with a plan, and their motto was that we'll create a healthcare services in India where nobody is deprived because of their capacity to pay. And I think this was the foundation on which we started building the healthcare services. Unfortunately, we didn't walk the talk. You know, the government did not invest. The only thing where we did really well was to produce doctors, people like me, you know, who came in. And when we all were produced, I remember my own time that when I went into medical school in early 1970s, I had to give a pledge, you know, 3 lakh rupees. 3 lakh rupees at that time was too big, right? A kind of surety that I will go and work in the rural area. When I finished it, I said, give me a job. I want to work in primary health center. They said, there are no jobs because there are no expansion of primary health center. We don't have budget to support you. So they themselves tore it away, saying that we are not going to implement this bond that you have signed. I had no money at that time, so I would have really worked there because that was the only choice I had. And that's the story. That all those doctors who came out, instead of their becoming serving in the public system, where healthcare is a public good, where I don't have to look at the background of the patient, those doctors had to go in the open market and become entrepreneur. And once you become entrepreneur, you can see that the interaction between entrepreneurship and your medicine. That is the trading and the medicine going together. I come from a trading family. My whole family was illiterate. I was the first generation literate there. And they were all doing wholesale business of grains, and my father was also a small industrialist. He was producing flour, gram flour. And I could see, you know, that was one of the reasons why I became totally allergic to any kind of trade, was seeing the way the trading is done. If you want to be successful as a trader, as a middleman, when you purchase and then sell to somebody with a margin for you, where you have to mix up grains in order to see that you get higher margins there, I could see that. And in Gujarati family, as you know, that from the childhood, the child is involved in the business from the beginning. So I could see all those things, learned how to do accounting, the accounting to be shown to the government, and accounting that we have to keep it to ourselves, the double accounting, which is always a part of every small business. I think that is what we all learned. And when I saw my own friends who came out of the medical school and they started their own small business, either general practice or small nursing home, all of them were doing the same thing that my father was doing. And I found this is the new ethics or new culture that was enveloping the medical profession. And as it developed, I don't go into the lot of economics indicators, but it's very simple that from small nursing homes and hospitals, we graduated to the large corporate entities in the 80s. Again, you have Apollo was the beginner, and Apollo was again started by a doctor, right? So you have a huge thing coming up, which is a corporate sector, where the emphasis is how to get the best return on the investment. The investor and management are separated. Management and those who are actually providing medical care are separated. Right, this is the situation that is what you will find in the corporate sector. So here it the whole power, the whole thing that pushes them to go forward is how you maximize your revenues. And that's where, they have to really make compromises. And they come under pressure to see that there is an overutilization of healthcare services. So what has happened because of this is very simple. Gradually, ideologically, as well as in real life, we started forgetting that the healthcare was a public good. We started saying, oh, it is your responsibility. With insurance coming, each one of us have to buy our own insurance because we have to take care of us. Yeah, there is some kind of risk, spread out in other people also. But yes, at the end, if you don't buy insurance, well, you are in trouble. Out-of-the-pocket expenditure is another one. If you don't have enough cash with you, you are in trouble. So this is a whole, things that we have come into. And that is a framework which decides how doctors are going to behave. As an ethicist, I keep always wondering that, should I go and educate every doctor about ethics? Is it going to change the entire stuff? After he comes to my class, he goes back and he has to behave the same way because that is what is the institution in which he is functioning requires him to do. So this is an area which really makes me little problematic about just asking people to change their heart and become better people. But even if they are good people, in their professional life, they have to do something that their business demands them to do. Now, coming to my another area is that this is what is happening in India, where our tradition tells you all the time that we are not individualistic, we are not Western kind of people, you know. We believe in Vasudeva Kutumbakam. I remember my childhood days, my teacher used to tell me that before you go to sleep, please find out whether your neighbor is hungry or not. If neighbor is hungry, not eaten, fight with your parents, but take a roti to that people and then go to sleep. This is what they used to tell me. And this was in primary school, a kind of, moral building that, that was done at that time. And I always thought that, yes, this is what we call in ethics solidarity, that you have to, take care of your fellow citizens. And we build a whole health system which is highly individualistic. Eh? We look with scorn at the Western people and said they are individualistic, but in the entire Western Europe and in Canada, they build a system which is based on solidarity. How do you explain that? What is the historical forces which shape two different kind of system, where if you are in Europe and if you fall sick at the time of sickness when you are dating something, you don't have to pay anything, you know. Most of them have either a national health system or they have a national insurance-based single payment access to the healthcare services as a part of your social security, which we don't have here. So this is I would say that it is so much against the ethos that we keep being proud of that we have not been able to fight enough in order to really change the larger framework. My last point, is that are doctors really happy about what is happening? Many of the doctors are. I meet young people. I also meet those who are at my stage and have become well-known consultants. Some of them are very happy because they say that, well, if I run a small nursing home, I have a problem of tax people, I have a problem of running it, I have a problem of my staff, and always the problem of violence if patient dies or there is some altercation with them. Now I have shifted. I've gone to the corporate hospital. They have their bouncer. They take care of everything. They take care of all other things of mine, Even my, various medical-related issues, for my upgradation of my skill and all, that is taken care of by them. So I'm very happy at that level. But on the other hand, when we talk to other doctors, many of them are not happy. They describe that We are being paid more, but it is as a part of a contract. It's a kind of a, different people are given different kind of employment, you know, contract. And that is what most of the big companies do. And so the terms of conditions of each one is very, very different. Some are pampered, others are pushed. They say that, well, there is insecurity of job. If you don't get certain kind of revenues, then they are thrown out, or they are replaced, or they come under pressure to overutilize all the diagnostic services available there, or wherever they are having some kind of alliance there. So the pressure is always there to have a performance targets. So there are many, many doctors. And there's a book that has come out, you might have seen it, called Dissenting Diagnosis, done by two of our friends, Dr. Arun Gadre and Dr. Abhay Shukla. And they interviewed large number of doctors, and they showed, you know, they are feeling very, very uneasy about what is happening. So there is also disquiet amongst doctors. You know, the corporate sector is not completely embraced there. So I think there is a hope. And that brings me to last point, that what needs to happen in order to bring the doctor-patient relationship from conflict to cooperation, and where can they cooperate? And here medical profession is a little bit, very problematic, corporate entity. When I was studying how systems change in UK and say Canada, I found that when they were trying to change the system, when Beveridge Committee was being implemented, British Medical Association was dead against it. The only small group called Socialist Health Association supported the government. Labour government was there. Socialist ideology was quite strong at the time. In Canada, when they brought the Medicare Act in mid-1960s, the Canadian Medical Association went on strike twice to oppose it, to stop it. Right? In 71, they brought the act. Many of the doctors shifted from Canada to US because that is where the private sector was thriving. But those who stayed back, and in UK and in Canada both, when I look and interact with them, I have got a lot of friends in the British Medical Association, when I interact with them, I find that they are the biggest supporter of the national health system there. When Margaret Thatcher tried to privatize it, the BMA doctors, the doctors from the medical association, put up boards in their own clinics and hospitals telling, you know, patients that we have to ally together to fight against this onslaught. We are very happy to serve you the way you are, you know. We don't want more. There is a private sector also existing in UK. And there are also a section of medical profession who want the entire thing to be privatized. But a large number showed that once they realized that with the money as a barrier gone, you don't have to discriminate patients on the basis of their class, you know, their paying capacity. We say that, well, don't discriminate on caste, religion, and all. We never say, what about the paying capacity? And doctors are cheerfully doing it today. It won't happen only when the national health system kind of system, you know, things are existing there. So this is a very, very important area where they can come together. And there is a Jan Swasthya Abhiyan and many other organizations which are campaigning for universal access to healthcare services in India, where this kind of doctors can link up. And my last point on this is that in the past, doctors who felt very uneasy with the system, they actually left the system. I was product of that time, you know, late 60s and early 70s, when I became politically aware. That was a time when many doctors left the private practice. You might have heard of the names of Dr. Rajnikant Arole and all, the Jamkhed project. You know, they went into the villages. The Medico Friend Circle came out of that, because those were the young doctors who were in Tarun Shanti Sena, and they realized that they cannot go and work in the mainstream. They have to go and reach out to those who are not rich at all. And they started, you know, community health workers scheme. They set up a small health centers and started providing care to them. My first research, when I started doing research in 1980s, was to study this kind of project. And what I found was that they were very dedicated and doing good work. But at the same time, because they went into the underserved area and they medicalized that area by, you know, taking medicine there, the private sector did not run away. Private sector saw the big market there. So when I was visiting Jamkhed, I found that the private sector were thriving. Not only that, they were building a big hospital in front of their own centers. So what I learned from that is that even those who are really committed, they should go to the unreached. But at the same time, they need to link up with the larger movement. Arole and others were working only at the two levels, either at the policymakers or to the grassroots level. They never worked at the middle level where the people's movements are existing, where people were trying to bring pressure on the politicians to pass laws and policies which makes healthcare accessible to everybody. Today we spend only 1% of the GDP, government 1.2% of the GDP on healthcare services. This is what government spend. Out of that, huge amount is going to, you know, the buying of the healthcare services through social insurance from the private sector. So what remains for the public sector to function? Now this is where I think there's a possibility of alliance. So although it may sound that doctors would go around and say that we need a law to have a security available 24 hours in the hospital to get protection from the violence, but that would be very foolish to believe that by doing a lot of curative work, the disease will disappear from the world. You know, no. By just having a curative work, the disease don't go away. You have to prevent them. And if you don't go into the public health and the prevention part, then I don't think the violence will go away. The more the police, the more the organized the violence will be. So that won't lead to the kind of cooperation that we need. Actually, we still distrust each other, and it will lead to more flaring up of things as it is happening in China. So we need to follow a different path, you know, where healthcare is made accessible to everybody. Without that, I don't think that kind of collaboration and cooperation between medicine and the society will be possible. Thank you very much.